thanks very much for coming. I guess this is the follow-on from the 100-year celebrations done in Broadway. Largely organised by done a fantastic job putting it all together. Keeping with the way we used to do it at school, I'll try and get over as quickly as possible. So excuse the slurring, but here we go. And with no disrespect to the blessing of food before a meal, this is the beginning of the entertainment. All right. Occhi omnibus expect and domine, today says his name, or in temper opportuno, and bears to mind to all the domine, from the on all the domine to a very questions, and domine to a Anyway, it's my pleasure to welcome all of you here tonight. I've been in contact through emails, as you've seen, with over, I would say, well over 100 Maltonians. Anyway, here we are, 30 years later since I left Milton, and over 10,000 kilometres from Bulawayo. So I think it's pretty special to get, I think we've got about 30 or 32 or whatever old Miltonians here, and I think that's brilliant. Yeah. The people that are visiting from outside Perth, I can't thank you enough, I think it's great. And I want to make mention of the people from Bunbury, the McKenzie brothers, Rory and Ian, their partners, John Thompson. And then the people from Melbourne, we've got Andrew Bucket, Steve McKenna, and Nelson Bollard. From Sydney, we've got Nadine and Sean McKelvin. And all the way from France, we've got Ricky DeToy. And we did manage to get one person from South Africa, from Vernon Raymond Carey. And then the last one, Alex Yard, all the way from Singapore. Thanks, Alex. I'd like to thank Pete for his efforts. He's put a huge amount of effort in the last few weeks. And you'll see later on, we're going to be showing some profiles that he's put together, but from all the stuff that's been sent to him. And it's absolutely excellent. And I want to thank Pete for being one of them. Another big special thank you is to Nelson Pollard for putting together these beautiful banners and the pull-up poster and also the beer mugs.
Welcome, Nelson.
I also want to thank in advance the other speakers, Steve McKenna, Rory McKenzie, and Adrian Abel are going to speak later on. Thank you. And then, lastly, I need to make a special thank you to Jane for her support. For me, that's probably the best thing that's come out of Milton.
Moffat, Niven, Polti, Quick, Riley, Sandler, Turner, and Webb. I don't actually try to review that, it just comes back. When you start going through, it just goes on. And I think it's interesting that those things stay with us for so long. What are the things that stay with us for so long? You know, when Paul said to me, you say a couple of words about the 60s. I thought, what am I going to say? I looked through the list of people who are here, and initially I didn't know anybody. I'm thinking, oh, by the way, I arrived at Milton in 1963. Does that make me the oldest Miltonian here?
Yeah. Oh, no way.
Anybody before that? Back to 1963. I arrived at Milton in 1963 and I had some really good things to help me. Form one, I had a friend called John Smith in Form 3. There was a fellow called Morgan Brown, some of you might remember. All kinds of stuff to help you get through the first couple of days, and then you're on your own. You're really there by yourself. And there were a couple of things that struck me about Milton when I was thinking back over what am I going to talk about? is I wanted to talk about things that perhaps you didn't have. There were things that we had in the 60s, which of course was the golden age. 1963, remember, I need real respect here. Real respect. I don't expect any. But it really was, in a lot of ways, it was the golden age. The traditions had all come through, everything was in place. We didn't have war, we didn't have hassles with teachers having to leave, call ups. We just had a really strong staff, we had a strong set of guys. You expected to start in Form 1 and go right through the Form 6, and that's the way it was. But there were a lot of things that we experienced in those early years that perhaps you didn't have. I've been looking at all the stuff coming up on the screen here, and I was going to talk about, I'm a teacher at the moment, I'm teaching at Bunbury Catholic College, and I'm teaching high school maths. Gee, I wish I could change our system here, especially reading some of those comments up there. There's a couple of things that I would bring back immediately. One of them kind of makes a swishing noise. That would make a huge difference to a lot of the problems. I believe that a lot of the problems that we have today would disappear. I actually looked around to see if I could find a cane. I went and asked some of the teachers at the school that I teach at, has anybody got a cane? And they all just said, you've got to be joking. You get caught with a cane, even in your room these days, you're gone. So I was going to come in here with a cane behind my back and just go, on the table. And watch, all of you guys go, woo! You should remember. That's what it's all about. And I was, you know, those days are gone. Is anybody here who didn't get a hiding?
Off this. We've got the Roll of Honour up there in memoriam. Guys who were killed in wars. There's been two world wars, there's been the Asian war, there's been a lot of other wars. There may be some names that are missing there. In memoriam, other people have died. If you know any names that are missing, please let us know. But would it be possible, please, to have just a minute of silence?
Thank you very much. The spirit and the character of Miltonians, past and present, is summed up by Milton's first headmaster, Mr. De Vere, on the occasion of the school's Silver Jubilee. Mr. De Vere, affectionately known as Dab, was explaining in his address how the school motto came into being. As we all know, the school motto is Greek and has its origins in St. Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians, and the authorized version translates it as Quit you like men. Dab suggested from the history of the school motto there are three great lessons to be drawn. The first being holism. Roughly translated, holism means that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. He went on by saying that sport is a very important element in a boy's life, and so is learning. But when the two are happily combined in one individual, we get a complete, well-rounded personality. A far more valuable entity than either a mere sportsman or a mere bookworm. The second great lesson is the necessity of heeding the call of duty. Miltonians have heeded the call with vigor in both world wars and as well as in the Bush War of the 70s. The war memorial that stands proudly at the entrance of the school is a timely reminder of the ultimate sacrifice made by so many Miltonians when called to duty. The final lesson, which is summed up in the modern scout motto, be prepared. It was explained by Dab as follows. Now you boys are really here to prepare yourselves. You're being put through a training, not for a few years of warfare, but for a lifetime of struggle. If you slack and gibbet it, you will never be able to give real service, and you will be failing your school and its fine traditions. These three great characteristics of holism, duty, and being prepared are what I believe all Miltonians are blessed with when they walk out of those hallowed gates for the last time. What I would do to be able to transport myself back to a different era. To be able to go back and savour the memories, the nostalgia of a different time. This was a place of foundations. place where one was fashioned into a well-rounded personality, armed with a call to duty, and prepared for a lifetime of struggle. In our time at Milton, we have witnessed a country in the midst of a war, a country trying to stave off the winds of change, which were inevitable and necessary. We have sadly had to bury some of our brothers, some of our best and bravest. We've witnessed the change and been exasperated by its brutality and futility. Our school, like our country, now stands in ruins, a shadow of its former glory. Do not despair, though, because the essence of the spirit of Milton will exist until the very last Arnoldtonian passes this earth. And so it is when one considers the history and the achievements of this fine school over the last century. We stand here tonight as part of a relatively small but fortunate group of men who can proudly say that we are Old Miltonians. Put you like me. Thank you.
So my task is to indicate the kind of differences in my era, or our era. And it's pretty cool because today I'm on the kids' table. And I tell you, it's been a long time since I've been on the kids' table. So that's pretty wicked. So we've heard the 60s, the 70s, and I guess I'm here to talk about a little bit about the 80s. It's very different. I got to Milton in 1980. Paul was my head boy. And I finished in 84. Just at that transition time, one of the biggest changes, I guess, was the fact that we'd had independence and that blacks were allowed into the school, which would be a little different from the 60s. When I left, there were 1,800 students at Milton. And I don't know how many in your guys' era, but I don't imagine more than 800, 900. I'm guessing. But there were 1,800 students. I remember thinking back, they were starting to talk about hot desking in the beginning. You enter as a skinny, squeaky, you know, sometimes fat, if that was your thing, hairless, and a virgin, you'd hope. You know, and after five years at Milton, you leave bloody hairy, your balls have dropped so you're not squeaking, you're shaving and sometimes twice a day, some of these guys, and you're probably still a virgin. Even in spite of the stories. And if you're a boarder, you're definitely a virgin. I remember those common room fights as well. I got into a scrap in the Morgan Quad, and a prefix caught me, and they thought they'd make a game of it, so they let's have some entertainment. So they called me and my adversary, and it was Hardman that reminded me of this, last night. And we had to entertain them at break time. They go, okay, now we're having our jam sandwiches and our tea, we're ready, now go. But it's an interesting concept because, you know, everybody, they had the fun watching, we resolved our issues, and we all went on our way. Our rugby team in my year was pretty good. I'm sure you all thought your rugby team was good in your year, but ours was really good. And under 13 and 14, we were unbeaten, and we were under 15s. And you won't remember this, Paul pulled me aside and said, my name at the time was Probert, because I changed my name. He said, I need to talk to you. I said, yeah, yes, tell us. He said, don't wear such tight shorts on the rugby field anymore, and stop rolling up your sleeves up to your armpits. There's an ancient tribe that they used to have 6 levels of warrior. And the top level of warrior was called the dog soldiers. And their position in battle was that they had a rope, and at the end of the rope was a stake, and the rope was tied around their waist, and they would go into battle with the rest of the warriors. And at a certain time in battle, when the battle was looking to turn and maybe they were in trouble, they would take the stake and they would hammer it into the ground, and that was it. That was the line in the sand. And their job was to stay at the end of that rope until everybody else had retreated, the women and children were safe, or another dog soldier came to take over. And that was it, that was their position. They either stayed there or they died. I reckon they went to Milton.
You got friends.